Hello and welcome everyone. Welcome to my YouTube channel. And in this video or in this webinar, you can say we are going to cover about one of the new framework which is popular in the market, which is a Next.js. Okay, it's not like any other framework we have till now, like HappyJS, CoaJS, Restify and all. It's a full featured framework which is somewhat similar to the Angular style, and I will say that developers are liking it. I'm using it since couple of months and I find it very useful for writing Node.js applications, because when we talk about Next.js and when we look at the code, the architecture, the folder structures, it looks similar to any other front-end framework like Angular, where we are creating controllers, services, factories and all. Okay, so we'll talk about Next.js in this. Next.js is a framework for building efficient, scalable Node.js server-side application. In one word, this can satisfy all your need for server-side applications. Okay, till today we are just learning about Express.js, but this is something which is built on top of Express.js just to make TypeScript more robust with Node.js. This framework will help you a lot. Okay, the underlying structure is Express, but that is not exposed to us. We will be writing a lot of things in TypeScript, and all the things whatever we are writing in TypeScript somewhat similar to what we do in our daily life. In Angular, we create pipes, route guards, we create modules, we create providers, services, controllers in Angular. I'm talking about Angular 8 or 9, whatever the latest version is. So it is adopting the same kind of philosophy. So if you are already an Angular developer and started learning Next.js, then it's like balle balle for you. You will be able to easily grasp it, will be able to learn very fastly. Okay. So how this is different from any other framework? First of all, this is something which is enabling the TypeScript for the server side. You're already writing the client side with Angular with the TypeScript enabled. Now you have this Next.js which is already supporting TypeScript. So it's like, you, if you are good at TypeScript, go ahead with Angular and the pair this Next.js for writing your server side APIs. Because in the client side, what we do is from the client side, we are just making HTTP request, and all those requests are being intercepted by the controllers of Next.js. So I will talk a little bit about the code, how the structure of Next.js is being built. But in Next.js fundamentals, if we talk about, it is some kind of the same structures what we do in Angular. It also has its own lifecycle process, lifecycle events. It is kind of same modular structure. In Angular, we create auth module, logger module, okay, login module. Same kind of modular structure you can create here. Those modules will have their controllers and services, okay, and it's purely in TypeScript. So you will feel like it's fun writing Next.js. So when we write Next.js controllers, so these are actually building blocks for Next.js. The controllers, providers, okay, the modules, middlewares. You might have heard about the basic components of Express.js is what? We used to create routes, controllers, and maybe a model layer. And we used to create middlewares to intercept the request and some error handlers. All these things we were creating in Express.js. Now, on top of that, let's say we have a Next.js, which is providing all these kind of interceptors. We have a middlewares, we have exceptional filters, we have modules, which is the advantage of using Next.js, that your application can be totally divided into a different modules. So you can see, we like in Angular, what we do is we create services, controllers, services are getting injected inside your components, right? So obviously, we will not have HTML components in Next.js, but the other things are kind of same. We have services and we have a controllers. This is kind of a MVC design pattern is adopted in Next.js. We have a services. We will be injecting those services in our controllers, and controllers are the front face for the request which we are going to get, right? So we are going to create a same kind of modules. In Angular world, we are calling them as an ng module, but in SJS, we'll just call them as modules. It can be ordered module, logger module, database module, Redis module, okay, and config module, NestJS ORM module, SQLize ORM module. So now your application will be divided in those module, and this modular structure is scalable, right? You will not have a conflict. You created a logger module, you created a Elasticsearch module, type ORM module, database module, Mongoose module for MongoDB. Okay, so everything is splitted, and you will have a one root module where you will inject all these. Same concept, we have these middlewares. Okay, before going further, I want to give you a little flavor about how this look like. This is not a tutorial session at all. I'm just talking about simple template which I'm using as a base for my projects. So here, this is a Node.js backend written in Nest.js. So this is a kind of, you can say, the entry point for my application. Okay, and I'm using Nest.js, and common is a core module. And here in this controller, what I'm saying is, I'm using these annotations, @controller for the services. I will be using @injectable. You might have seen these kind of annotations with Angular, annotation injectable. For dependency injection, I created this item service. Now, if I wanted to inject this item service, what I will do is I will create a constructor injection by private property, item service. This is already a service, so this can be injected into item controller. So whenever there is any request, HTTP request coming for /, you can say items, HTTP get. So what will happen? We will be intercepting this request here, and this request is forwarded to this service. So service will be dealing with all the ORM components, like getting the data from the MongoDB, MySQL, or any different kind of database. And you can say that we are using these kind of annotations, @get, @post. If anybody is coming from the Java background and worked on the Spring Boot, there also we use these kind of Spring annotations to create the REST endpoints. But it's giving a good feeling that now we are writing the classes, dependency injections, all these provider patterns we are using in the Nest.js. So it's becoming more powerful, and for Angular developers, it's quite easy to learn. So now this is a HTTP get for the items, it's HTTP post, and whatever you are sending, I will be capturing that in the DTO. DTO is nothing but a model class I have created just to capture and do the validations on the body. So out of the box, you don't need to go anywhere. You can create a guards, you can create a custom pipes, you can create an exception handler, middlewares. All these things will be there in the Nest.js. If I talk about the common packages, Nest.js core and common has all the core dependencies about the Nest.js. Then we can use our MySQL 2 packages with the type ORM. Type ORM, we'll cover that in another playlist and webinar. Type ORM is one of the becoming popular ORM for the TypeScript. So we interact with the MySQL or different kind of database. So type ORM can be object relational data mapper for our entities. We don't need to write the hard code queries. We can just use the functions provided by them. Coming back to our Nest.js, so we can create a custom middleware. What these middlewares will do is just intercepting between your request and controllers. So if you wanted to do the token validations, request validations, all the other custom properties which you want your request to have, all these things can be done by these middlewares. Similarly, we have auth guards. Okay, in Angular definitions, we create a route guards. Okay, I don't want to allow to user to go to this particular endpoint or particular page before satisfying this condition. So we can create a guard, we can have a exception filters. Nest.js provide you the custom built exceptions like not found exception, internal server exceptions, custom made exceptions. Okay, so we have all these things. Like you can also create pipes are nothing but data filters, right? So Nest.js comes with a built-in exception layer which is responsible for processing all unhandled exceptions. So sometimes we get internal server exception, HTTP exceptions. So all the inbuilt exceptions are already provided by this. We always deal with importing another library for sending the custom HTTP message and status code. You don't need to look for it. So if you are using Nest.js, you don't need to look for anything else. You just need some Nest.js modules for a simple application. And Nest.js pipes are also there, which is used for the transformation of the request. If you want a particular input, then you will be using the pipes and decorators. Okay, interceptors. It is used to intercept a request which we are having. So interceptors, Nest interceptor is there. So it is like, you might have heard about aspect oriented programming in Spring Boot. What it does, if you wanted to do something additionally apart from handling the request response, like pre-processing, post-processing of a particular request, then before, after a method execution, you wanted to run some extra logic. In that case, you can use these interceptors. Okay, coming to the tools, Nest.js comes with a Nest CLI. Okay, you know Angular CLI, right? Similarly, Nest.js comes with a Nest CLI. You can create a just npm install minus the Nest CLI. You can create a basic skeleton of application. Nest.js comes with a OpenAPI Swagger. It's just a module inside a Nest.js. So till today, we are creating a spec YML and just exposing them to the Swagger module. You don't need to do it. You just use some annotations on your routes. It will create your Swagger. It will create your API definitions from Swagger portal. Testing, it provides you the E2E testing and unit testing. So you might have already done the unit testing of Angular components by bootstrapping the modules. Same kind of logic we are doing here with Nest.js. Okay. Other modules, important modules will be Nest.js TypeORM, which is a popular if you wanted to deal with the database. TypeORM is from the name type plus ORM. So it provides a TypeScript, good support for TypeScript script. Other than that, we have a SQLize, which is also a TypeScript support. But TypeORM is a more popular. We have HTTP module, WebSocket. If you look at the Nest.js website and just see what all features it is providing, then there are a whole lot of it supports WebSockets. GraphQL, you can also create a Nest.js CRUD. So in just writing three lines of a code, I will try to see if I have the Nest.js CRUD here. Yes. So I'm just specifying the controller. I'm using Nest.js CRUD module for this particular feature. I just provided the entity. That's it. So what it will do, it will create a create, update, insert, delete all the routes for the contact. And it will be using just contact service. You don't need to specify this contact service. We just need to do a basic thing. You just need to inject a repository. That part will come later. I will just not be explaining this right away. So you can just create a Nest.js CRUD. Nest.js supports GraphQL, WebSocket. You can create a Nest.js microservices which can interact with each other. Okay. Microservices are there. Nest.js has a good GraphQL support. So if you are, okay, I'm not looking for HTTPS, I want to write a GraphQL endpoints, then it is providing the type definitions and resolver functions which you need to add for your services. It will create a GraphQL definitions and GraphQL APIs for you. I mean, basic concept of GraphQL is you just need to provide a type definitions and resolvers for your all your type definitions. It will create it. Other are like it is evolving and a lot of modules are coming, but it's not going to stop because I see this is getting more popular. And the reason for the popularity is we don't need to look outside Nest.js inbuilt providing all the things. Now let's talk about little bit of the code. Okay, so here we have a controller, simple item controller. If you see the items and get and post, and here I created a service. So service is just returning the items, it's just an array. I will be maintaining this from the mock data or getting this data from the database. Currently just a mock data, empty array. I will just returning empty array. For creating, I will be pushing the new item. Okay, now while creating the APIs, what all things we understand, sometimes we need middleware, sometimes we need a request payload validations, we need a exception handling, we need interceptors, few things which we used to do in Express. So if we talk about a few aspects here, like how we are doing, how we are mapping, how we are capturing the request body. So you can see I created a DTO, create item DTO, and here I'm doing a validation using class validator. So this is a powerful module. What it is doing is, it is just checking in the request payload, I should be getting only name and price. Name should be of type string, both should be of type, one should be of type string, another of number. And you can just provide all the input, all the properties, okay, what all things it will have. Add the rate is undefined, is new. So all these things are there in the class validator. Is int, is string, similarly is not null. All these properties are there on the class validator. So if you wanted to add a custom validations, you can do here. This is a request payload validation. Then once we talk about entities, entities means we will be using the type ORM, which is a ORM for connecting to the database. You just need to create entities compatible to type ORM. Now you can connect to the MySQL, Postgres, or any kind of database. You just need to create these kind of entities with the annotations, like ID is a primary key. Other than that, we have these particular columns which are unique, nullable. All these annotations are there. Create date column. This column is unique, true, nullable, false. This is the primary key, length, all these attributes. So whenever, like, all these ORMs has the migration capability, seeding the data capability and all these things. So we just need to write the entities, and we just need to use the Nest.js type ORM module to just provide, feed these entities there, and we are good to go. We just need a good credentials about MySQL or any other database, initialize the database connections using Nest.js type ORM modules, and we are good. Controllers will handle our, controllers will be the gatekeeper. Now these requests will be transferred to the services. Services will deal with these type ORM methods, which is about find, find all, find by ID, all these CRUD operations or any kind of update we are doing. Okay, these are the services, if you see item service. And finally, we can create a different kind of modules. So if I talk about my root module of the application, in Angular also, one should be the root module. So all the other modules I will be importing here, entity module, logger module, swagger module, Redis module, whatever the modules I have in my application, I will import all of them. The controllers, I have all the controllers and the app module. And then in the main.ts, I'm just bootstrapping my main module app.listen, and I'm just getting the port from the config service and running the Nest.js service. You can get this code from the Nest.js CLI, but what I'm trying to say is Nest.js is a framework for writing the bulletproof APIs, which what I will say, because it is foolproof, providing all the required things. So you can get started and you can migrate your Express applications to the Nest.js right away. Next, what I will be doing is I will be creating a tutorial series about Nest.js with MongoDB, Redis, and MySQL, using all these different Nest.js modules, Nest.js Redis, Nest.js CRUD, Nest.js type ORM, and we'll go from there. Okay, so till now there is no disadvantage, all only advantage from Nest.js. So thanks everyone, thanks for watching.